Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Evolution is Wrong, a Radical Approach to the Origin and Transformation of Life by Erich von Daniken, narrated by Charles Constant. Publisher's note: in this audio edition, you will hear references to figures present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Chapter 1: Things Animals Are Capable of. Parasitic species. Imagine the following scenario. In flight, a wasp heads for its victim, a spider. The wasp stabs the spider in the back from behind and injects poison into the wound, paralyzing it. The wasp then lays an egg in the damaged part of the spider's body. The larva develops inside, and once it hatches, the newborn feeds on the host's innards. It begins by gradually devouring those parts of its victim that are not important for the spider's survival. This way, the spider stays alive and fresh as long as possible. This scenario plays out every day. In Australia, everyone knows of the so-called Captain Cook or red-back spider-hunting wasp, Aegineoideus nigricornis. This small, annoying insect reproduces with the help of the poisonous red-back spider. As with the well-known black widow, the redback spider's bite can be fatal. Because of this, every year in Australia, hundreds of people are treated with a serum after they are bitten by this spider. Of course, we know that venomous spiders kill other life forms, but who kills the venomous spiders? Entomologists Patrick Honan from the Museum of Victoria, Australia, and Lars Krogman from the State Museum of Natural History in Stuttgart, Germany, asked this question. The results were astonishing. Both the little red-back spider-hunting wasp and its larger conspecific spider wasps, Pompilinae, attack venomous spiders and use the spiders' bodies as breeding grounds for their young. Several other species of wasps have mastered the art of abusing foreign hosts. The braconids, Dinocampus coccinelli, manage to manipulate ladybugs. Similar to the pompilids, the braconid wasp lays an egg in its victim's abdomen, and the wasp larva feeds on the beetle's body fluids. As soon as the larva has reached a certain size, however, it crawls out of the ladybug and pupates on the beetle's abdomen. This makes the ladybug mostly motionless, but its legs still twitch. After the new braconid wasp hatches, the ladybug recovers and can even reproduce again. Obviously, the wasp realm has developed phenomenal methods of feeding its brood. The jewel wasp, Ampulex compressa, ambushes cockroaches, Paraplaneta americana. Even though these roaches are 10 times larger than the wasp, this doesn't prevent the wasp from suddenly jumping out of hiding and paralyzing its prey with the first sting. It aims the second sting directly at the roach's nervous system, precisely at the region that controls its escape capability. The wasp then uses the cockroach's antenna to direct its prey to a hole in the ground and, like a zombie, the cockroach moves on its six legs to its own grave. Once the roach is there, the wasp lays an egg in the cockroach and then builds walls around it with small stones. After 4 weeks, a new jewel wasp hatches out of that prison and looks for its next victim. The cockroach is dead. The ichneumonidids, ichneumonidae, are masters of an even more perfidious procedure. The ichneumonid's host is the well-known orb spider, Plesiomata argyra. The process is similar to the previous stories. First, the parasitic wasp paralyzes this spider with a sting. The wasp then lays an egg in the spider's abdomen. The larva feeds on the spider's innards and grows. As soon as the larva is ready to hatch, the wasp, which has to stay close at all times, injects a new poison into the spider, which changes its behavior. Instead of weaving an orb web, as is innate, the spider begins to use its threads to wrap a cocoon around the larva. When this cocoon is ready, the parasitic wasp kills its victim and eats it. The wasp larva continues to grow and finally leaves its cocoon. Speaking of orb weaver spiders, Darwin's bark spider, Chirostris darwini, produces spider webs with threads of up to 25 meters, 82 feet in length. How? The spider positions itself in an air draft and lets the wind carry its silk across a stream or pond. The spider then climbs over its construct and affixes a new anchor thread to a place next to it. It then lets itself fall, the spider bungee jumping, and be carried by the wind to the other bank. It repeats this game, starting from two main threads until it has created a gigantic net that lies over the body of water. The most amazing thing about this construction is not the size of the web, but the strength of the spider's threads. The silk is 10 times stronger than Kevlar, synthetic fibers used not only in jeans made for motorcyclists, but also in bulletproof vests. In fact, the threads of Darwin's bark spiders are the toughest biomaterial in the world. Not only are they incredibly strong, they are also extremely light and thin. The mysterious evolution or desire of the spider must have prompted this. If they are going to make such long threads, they must make them stronger than the silks of all other conspecifics. These examples raise perplexing questions. What was going on when the first jewel wasp pounced on a cockroach 10 times its size? How did it know that its sting had to hit the exact point in the nervous system that controlled its victim's ability to escape? The wasp could not have known the structure of the cockroach's nervous system. If the sting missed, the cockroach would have killed the much smaller wasp. And how was it its experience passed on to the next generation? And which chemical brew was necessary to change the brain of an orb weaver spider in such a way that, instead of a web, it wove a protective cone around an alien being? What is the evolutionary mystery that creates the right mix of chemicals in the wasp's body? And what about the host animals? Is what concerns them all normal and nothing extraordinary? Nature, I will come back to this later, in fact, knows innumerable parasites that need host bodies to feed their brood. After all so-called neuroparasites abuse their host's nervous systems for their own purposes. The flatworm, or fluke, in the class Trematoda, for example, is a neuroparasitic monster with male and female reproductive organs. In other words, the worms can fertilize each other as well as themselves. And for them, one host is not enough to go through their life cycle. After the worm has moved on to suckle on another animal, the first host lays eggs at some point. These get into the water, and larvae, the miracidia, hatch from them. They swim around until they are either eaten or encounter a special snail. In the latter case, the miracidium bores into the skin of the snail and grows into a brood tube. After several metamorphoses, daughter sporocysts develop from these tubes, and these afflict the midgut gland of the snail. This is where rod larvae develop, which in turn produce tail larvae. From this, cercariae grow, which leave the host snail and enter a new intermediate host. Other flukes use caterpillars as hosts. These caterpillars are subsequently eaten by birds. The eggs of the fluke are spread through the bird droppings, and the cycle starts all over again. This all seems very simple, right? But how does the fluke know that the caterpillar it is abusing as a host is being eaten by a bird, and that the bird droppings guarantee the survival of its species? We have all heard about the tapeworm, Cystocephalus solidus, but who is aware that the larva of this disgusting animal needs a bird to mate? Even the beginning of the tapeworm's life cycle is spooky. A tiny crustacean, a copepod, eats the larvae of the latter tapeworm. This copepod, in turn, has to be eaten by a small, three-spined fish of the stickleback type. The stickleback then literally offers itself up to be eaten by a bird. These larvae can only grow in this three-spined stickleback. The whole process does not work with any other fish. And at some point, the larvae have to get into a bird to mate. The birth of the parasitic crab hacker barnacle, Saculina carcini, seems just as impossible. This barnacle abuses a crab to help its offspring. How does it work? After a process of insinuating itself in its host, it forms a small sac on the crab's abdomen in which its own kind of eggs can grow. The male crab hacker barnacle then fertilizes these eggs, and the crab tends and guards the foreign brood in this sac as if they were its own. In cases where this barnacle infects a male crab rather than a female, another miracle happens. The parasite affects the hormones of the originally male crab and causes it to mutate into a female organism. abracadabra. Even ants can be controlled by parasites. It seems that for nature, whatever nature is supposed to mean, even the impossible is possible. A parasite called the lancet liver fluke, Dicrocelium dendriticum, attacks grazing animals such as sheep or cattle. Its larvae are excreted in the feces of these animals. Snails then feed on this excrement and develop cercariae, which enter the snail's respiratory system. The snail spits out the cercariae in tiny slime balls. This slime is then eaten by ants, and it is only at this point that the original lancet liver fluke becomes active. This mucus enters the ant's nervous system and changes it completely. The ant positions itself on the tip of a blade of grass and waits to be eaten by a grazing animal. If this does not happen during the first day, the ant returns to its burrow and repeats its behavior until it is swallowed. Well, you might be thinking that's just what animals do. But you may be surprised to discover that parasites even control humans. In the journal Spektrum der Wissenschaft, Spectrum of Science, biologist Sabrina Schroeder drew attention to a parasite that can change humans. The animal is called Toxoplasma gondii and was discovered in Tunisia as early as 1907. The parasite triggers the disease toxoplasmosis, which in turn changes the behavior of humans and animals. Toxoplasmosis is now known worldwide and is mainly spread through cat feces. If a rodent, for example, a mouse, ingests Toxoplasma gondii, it loses its innate fear of cats and literally offers itself to its archenemy to be eaten. Neurologists suspect that this parasite can cause diseases such as schizophrenia in humans. Studies have shown that people with toxoplasmosis are more prone to depression and suicide. In addition, toxoplasmosis can lead to inflammation of the brain, encephalitis. Humans are infected through exposure to cat excrement. What evolutionary processes must these and many other animals have gone through? Think of the first wasp that attempted to fly onto a highly venomous spider. Spiders are clever opponents who defend themselves not only with their claws and by sucking the life out of their prey, but also with their sticky threads. Why did a wasp come up with the life-threatening idea of attacking a venomous spider millions of years ago, if you like? At the time, there were, after all, enough other more harmless life forms crawling around on the ground. How did the wasp get the idea to lay its eggs in the wound of a completely alien species? After all, the spider was not one of its related species that could be entrusted with its brood. And how does the wasp larva in the bowels of the spider know which innards it has to tap in sequence so that its host remains fresh and alive for as long as possible? Where does the wasp's offspring get its information from? And basically, in what way is this cycle supposed to have started? How did the first wasp egg get into the body of the venomous spider? Which came first, the chicken or the egg? The first wasp or the first wasp larvae in the spider's belly? And why is the process so cumbersome anyway? Wasps couldn't lay their eggs anywhere. Why, of all places, in the body of a living, venomous spider? Dangerous spiders. Over hundreds of millions of years, as the theory of evolution teaches us, around 40,000 different species of spiders developed. All of them had to come from some primordial spider, and all have since developed completely different capabilities. The Australian funnel web spider, Agelenidae, is considered to be the most venomous spider in the world because it kills so quickly. It developed a venom that is only lethal to primates and insects, but not to animals such as rabbits or chickens. How did this strange venomous cocktail that kills some animals and not others come about? Most of the spiders on our globe kill their prey with venom. First, they catch their victim, often but not always in the web, then they kill it. One of the large European spiders is the mighty green-fanged tube web spider, Segestria florentina. It lives mainly in narrow cracks, crevices in the rock, or on tree bark, and grows up to 4 centimeters, 1.5 inches in size. Its venom is painful to humans but not fatal. The same is true for the Goliath bird eater, Theraphosa blondii. It can grow to be 12 centimeters, over 4.5 inches tall, and weighs 200 grams, more than 7 ounces. It can evoke fear for sure, but it's not dangerous to humans. Nor does it hunt birds, as its name might suggest. Rather, it preys on insects and vertebrates, such as mice and frogs. The same applies to the European tarantula wolf spider, Lycosa tarantula. It looks just as terrifying as the Goliath bird-eater spider and can inflict painful bites on people, but they are not fatal. Spiders, spiders, spiders with different hunting behavior and various weapons. And they are all related to one another. A water spider, also called a diving bell spider, Argyonetra aquatica, breathes air but then dives underwater and carries the air with it in a breathing bubble. In terms of evolution, this is about as perverse as the whale, a mammal that lives in water. Spiders feed on land. They are armed with all kinds of weapons to catch their food, often webs or venom. So what makes a spider create an air bubble and hunt underwater? After all, there it can be easily eaten by fish. A dangerous arachnid native to Germany is the yellow sac spider, Cherokanthium. This microbeast does not build a web, but instead hunts its prey at night. Its bite causes chills, vomiting, and circulatory failure in humans. Why am I listing all these spiders? Well, I'm interested in their different behavior and their various weapon systems, all of which have arisen in the course of evolution, says the theory. After all, Charles Darwin, 1809 to 1882, discovered the diversity of species more than 150 years ago and postulated the idea of geographical variations. Everything has a common ancestor but develops differently in different regions. There are different forms of the black widow, Latrodectus tradesimgutatus, in Europe, as well as in North and South America. Their bites can all be fatal, though rarely are, to humans. In addition, many female black widows eat their male counterparts after mating. As a thank you for fertilization? With their venom, they not only kill beetles but lizards as well. Attention! Black widows feel comfortable under planks around construction sites, also on the underside of toilet seats. But at least evolution has provided a warning signal. The Mediterranean black widow wears 13 fiery red dots on their dark bodies. With this, the animal signals, "I am dangerous, do not touch." At least, that's what the theorists think. But why does the deadly Brazilian wandering spider, Phoenutria nigriventor, not also carry this warning sign? The brown recluse spider, Losoxyles reclusa, is considered the most dangerous venomous spider in the United States. Curiously, this little animal only has 6 eyes, in contrast to common spiders that have 8. Was evolution satisfied with 6 eyes? Wouldn't 8 have been more prudent? And then there is the Brazilian wandering spider, Phoenutria nigriventor. It is one of the deadliest animals in the world. Its venom is 20 times stronger than that of the black widow. The spider can be very aggressive and attack its prey with one jump. Their bite leads to muscle paralysis in humans and, as after a venomous snake bite, sometimes causes the heart and lung muscles to fail, resulting in a horrible death. All of these strange creatures leave us with questions. It is not only their different mixtures of venom, their strange hunting methods, and the way they abuse strange animals and use them as breeding grounds, but it is also their often unspeakable origins. Metamorphosizing insects. Butterflies and moths are a prime example of this, including the Atlas moth, Atticus atlas, with a wingspan of up to 30 centimeters, more than 11 inches. Like many insects, the Atlas moth has compound eyes, which are made up of around 8,000 smaller eyes. It also has 2 larger individual eyes. Its antennae are slightly splayed. With these features, the male can smell a female from greater distances. These characteristics are urgently needed because the Atlas moth is focused on creating offspring quickly. It only lives for a few days after it becomes a moth and doesn't eat anything during that time period. The Atlas moth, as is the case with its conspecifics, butterflies, does not simply come about through a birth of whatever kind. Before its short winged adult life, it has to go through three stages of development: egg, caterpillar, pupa. It is the final transition between pupa and moth that makes the life cycle of the moth/butterfly very confusing in evolutionary terms. When caterpillars emerge from butterfly eggs, they do the actual eating for the latter adult butterfly. Each caterpillar consists of 14 evenly lined up segments with a head at the front. After hatching, caterpillars first eat their own shell and then proceed to eat seeds, needles, and leaves from various plants. They are downright voracious. Some species of caterpillars do it slightly differently, however. They live with ants in peaceful harmony. These caterpillars secrete a sugary liquid that attracts ants. The ants climb on a caterpillar, not to kill them or to scare them away with their formic acid, but to get at this sweet food. The ants then drag the caterpillar into their burrow. There it takes on the smell of the ants. It lets the ants feed it, and at the same time it produces its sweet juice. Finally, after the ants maneuver their guest into a small niche, it pupates while the ants protect it from predatory conspecifics. The pupa stage, this stage in all insects, not just butterflies, contains a magical genetic program. The cells of the pupae are totally transformed while a physical reorganization process takes place. Pupae have neither legs nor wings, let alone eyes or genital organs. In order for a caterpillar to become a butterfly, a completely new body has to emerge. In the case of the Atlas moth, the entire shape of the animal has to change. 8,000 smaller eyes, the compound eyes, grow together with the two separate eyes, and all previous structures of the caterpillar disappear. Finally, a new life form hatches, the butterfly. In various ancient cultures, the butterfly was considered a symbol of rebirth, and artists of the Christian world recognized in it the power of resurrection. The soul leaving the dead body was shown as the butterfly. Obviously, wise men already practiced scientific thinking thousands of years ago. For a long time, they had observed what was happening in the life cycle of the butterfly, how an egg was formed into a caterpillar and then transformed into a butterfly through the process of pupation. But they could not know anything about genetics and therefore could not possibly ask the questions of our time. Each program for developing a life form originates in the cell, and this cell contains the DNA code, the double spiral of deoxyribonucleic acid. It is the DNA that carries the genetic information. Without DNA, nothing happens in the cell. I will come back to this. But where should the information come from that creates a completely new body out of the pupa? This information must already have existed in the egg. What causes evolution to create a life form like a butterfly by means of such a complicated path? And why does the adult form only live just a few days without eating anything? Why certain caterpillars let themselves be fed by ants may be explainable. It just worked out that way. But the genetic process that turns an egg into a caterpillar, then from a caterpillar to a pupa from which a completely new creature emerges, is difficult to reconcile or explain in terms of evolutionary theory. The information in the DNA strand in the cell also contains stop and go commands. When, in the course of time, will the next molting of the pupa be enabled? When does the basic wing form arise? When do the yellowish wing tips form? When do the slightly fanned antennae develop? When do the mouth parts grow? How about the legs and the 8,000 eyes? The sensory organs. Butterflies not only have eyes, but also have ears. The message of the genes must not only be read in the right sequence, but the correct processes must also take place at the right point in time. Otherwise, deformities will occur. For example, several species of the blister beetle, Meloidae, are unable to fly despite their wings because their wings are too short. Obviously, the stop signal for growth came too early. Incidentally, blister beetles owe their name to an oily liquid that leaks from the pores of the animal's leg joints, which can cause blisters when it comes in contact with exposed skin. This liquid acts as a defense against ants and other animals. As with butterflies, blister beetles go through several metamorphoses before they become adults. Their larvae develop in the nests of certain types of bees, such as sand or fur bees. The pupa emerges from the larva, and next to it, inexplicably, an empty dummy pupa emerges. Finally, a new blister beetle creeps out of the skin of the real pupa. And all of this has quite clearly been arranged by evolution. Freshwater to saltwater and back. Such wonderful evolutionary quirks also resulted in different subspecies of the salmon. There are 9 such subspecies worldwide, but they all have one thing in common. They are born in freshwater, swim into the distant salty sea, and years later, return to their place of birth. There are salmon in both the Atlantic and Pacific. The female Atlantic salmon, Salmo salar, lay their eggs in the upper reaches of rivers. After spawning, the majority of the adult fish die. After they hatch, depending on the water temperature, the young fish stay in the river for 1 to 3 years, during which time their eyes, gills, and dorsal fins develop. They become hunters. At this point, a change in their bodies begins. The blue and red spots on their skin disappear, and a shimmering color covers the animal. Their innards undergo a metamorphosis. The freshwater fish becomes a saltwater creature. Salmon researcher William Shearer found that most salmon swim into the Atlantic towards West Greenland. Why they do this is unknown. The situation is similar with Canadian salmon. There are 5 different species, the largest of which is the Chinook salmon, Oncogringus shawitshaw. Adults swim around 1,300 kilometers, from the Pacific via the Fraser River and the McLennan River to Swift Creek near the city of Valemont, British Columbia, Canada, to the place where they were born. Another salmon species, the sockeye salmon, Oncogringus nerka, also has to swim up the Fraser River and overcome massive rapids at Hell's Gate. As if under the influence of a drug or out of an inner rage, the fish jump again and again, throwing themselves toward the waterfalls in order to overcome them with lightning-fast movements. At the top of the rapids, grizzlies and black bears are perfectly positioned. They grab the very fatty meal when the salmon jump in the air. What drives these fish? Although the entire American continent lies in between these species, from Alaska, Canada, and the U.S. to Central and South America to Tierra del Fuego, both the Canadian and the Atlantic salmon have the same instinct. The fish in both bodies of water behave the same way. A salmon may have covered thousands of kilometers in its lifetime, but after years it finds the mouth of its home river with impeccable certainty. Only in this river does it swim upstream with tremendous exertion and overcomes rapids to be devoured by a bear. Which navigation system directs these fish? The Earth's magnetic field? In fact, cells containing magnetic iron oxide were found in the salmon mucous membrane. However, that does not solve the riddle. After all, the Atlantic and Pacific salmon have lived separately from one another for millions of years. The magnetic fields in east and west are different. In addition, several magnetic pole shifts have been proven to have occurred during this time frame. In other words, the magnetic field has reversed. And speaking of the magnetic field, it would never deviate in a narrow, limited geographical area to such an extent that zones with different strengths would emerge. This means that several rivers that lie in one area and are sought out by salmon would hardly be distinguishable from one another for the animals. How do they know which is the right one for them? Even the thought that the fish would orient themselves toward the stars isn't plausible. It is well known that the Earth is not a perfect sphere. It is slightly flattened at the poles. That is why it wobbles on its axis. In astronomy, this movement is called precession. In the course of 25,800 years, people and animals have seen different constellations again and again. Today, the sun stands in front of the constellation of Pisces at the beginning of spring. In 6,450 years, it will be the constellation of Sagittarius. 12,900 years after that, it will be the constellation of Virgo, then Gemini, and so on. It does not help to imagine that some form of the primeval salmon memorized a constellation and passed it down to all its subsequent generations. Salmon do not practice astronomy. And besides, what magic spell causes the animals to change not only their skin, but also their innards, so they can switch from fresh to salt water? I read somewhere that the animals swim down the rivers in search of food found in the very distant ocean. This is nonsense. The food in the river is just as abundant as that in the ocean. In addition, salmon, males and females, finally return to their nutritionally weak home river. It has also been suggested that it is the fish's sense of smell that directs them precisely to their home waters. I'm sorry, what? The rivers pour into the gigantic masses of water of the oceans. There, in the salt water, even the smallest special scent from a river 1,000 kilometers, 620 miles away, is lost. So the answers, so far, are unsatisfactory. Let's keep in mind that each female salmon releases around 30,000 eggs into the water when she spawns. Every egg has to contain the genetic information, which, in broad terms, is to reach adulthood, to change appearance and organ structure, to swim to the distant saltwater ocean, to let the internal navigation computer develop, and, finally, to return to the place of birth. It should be noted that salmon did not acquire this information in an evolutionary process lasting hundreds of millions of years. No, the information was already in the genes of the first salmon. Otherwise, the life cycle could never have started or continued. And the opposite, the European eel. And why is the eel species programmed in the complete opposite way when compared to salmon? Let's look at it step by step. European eels, Anguilla anguilla, live in freshwater rivers, lakes, and lagoons for years, and then swim to the saltwater Sargasso Sea, the place of their birth, some 6,500 kilometers, over 4,000 miles away, the exact opposite of what salmon do. The Sargasso Sea, located between Florida, the Bahamas, and Bermuda, is larger than the Mediterranean. There, like salmon, female eels spawn and die. The males fertilize the spawn and tiny eggs grow. These become larvae that drift toward Europe with the ocean currents. Here they mature into young eels, which fight their way up the rivers in large swarms. After a few years, they become sexually mature. Then their appearance changes. The dark eel takes on the form of a shiny, silvery fish adapted to the sea. The eels want to go back to their place of birth and swim down the rivers. Sometimes there are problems with this. In an article about eel migrations, Karstner Jasner writes, "If the path to the river is cut off because the animals live in ponds or pools, they quickly meander across land. This is made possible by the animals' fantastic adaptation to their environment. They have special gills and can breathe through their moist skin. And, of course, they can exist in both fresh and seawater." As with salmon, attentive scientists are looking for the reasons for eel migration. Norwegian researchers, working with marine biologist Caroline de Riff, placed the animals in closed tanks and exposed them to various magnetic fields. Depending on the magnetic field and water temperature, the eels oriented themselves in different directions. But what inner compulsion forces them, year after year, to leave their nourishing river landscape, which offers optimal conditions, and hone in on the Sargasso Sea so far away? With the huge distances and different ocean currents, the smell of home explanation doesn't help. The proposed explanations, whether they have to do with the availability of food, water temperature, or the magnetic field, also sound hollow. If these were plausible, countless other life forms would be affected as well, but they have no intention of adapting their behavior to that of the eels. Using electricity underwater, the electric eel. Another snake or fish-like animal is the electric eel, Electrophorus electricus. This animal isn't actually an eel.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.